William Morrow and Harper Audio present Hairpin Bridge, a novel by Taylor Adams. Performed by Lulu Lam and Sophie Amoss. Part 1. Four Small Fires. Chapter 1. Lena.
You look exactly like her.
Lena Nguyen had heard this many times before, and never got any less upsetting, being someone else's walking, talking ghost.
And you were twins.
She nodded.
Identical, right?
She nodded again. Something changed behind the state trooper's eyes, and he looked regretful, like he had already committed an offense by not starting with this.
I'm so sorry for your loss.
Another greatest hit. Lena made polite eye contact.
I can't imagine what it's like to lose a sibling.
No one ever could.
Just try to take it one day at a time.
The oldies kept coming.
You'll never get over it, but someday you will get past it.
That's a new one, Lena thought.
She'd add it to the list.
Corporal Raymond Reshevik had agreed to meet her here in a gravel parking lot shared by the Magma Springs Diner and a Shell station, 60 miles outside of Missoula. An exodus of wildfire evacuees fed a constant stream of passing traffic, and the highway hit a dangerous junction here, under two blind corners and no stoplight. Corporal Reshevik himself was a gorilla-like man stuffed into a tan-brown highway patrol uniform, pulled taut to contain him, all shoulders and biceps and a gentle smile. He had shaken Lena's hand with earnest delicacy. He had bags under his eyes, the soft color of bruises. Thank you for doing this, she said.
Of course.
I really appreciate it, you know, with you being on the clock and all. He half smiled.
My shift is over.
He studied her again for a long moment, still transfixed, and Lena felt a familiar impatience. Discussing her sister with strangers always felt like this, a choose-your-own-adventure book she'd memorized ages ago. She knew exactly what Reshevik was thinking before he said it, his words arriving right on schedule.
I'm sorry, I can't get over how much you look just like her.
You should try it, she thought sourly. It's awful. Grieving for someone while seeing her face in the mirror every single morning.
It must be awful, seeing her face in the mirror every morning. Every day, anything with a reflection, even a car mirror, can just blindside you.
She looked at him.
You have my sympathy, Lena.
Yeah, and maybe I underestimated you, Ray. A squealing hiss startled her. She turned. An 18-wheeler had taken the turn too fast. For a stomach-fluttery moment, 10 tons of rolling cargo skidded directly at them on locked tires. Then the truck swerved back into its lane, and Corporal Reshevik watched the tinted windows pass, as if expecting the driver to apologize. He didn't. The engine throttled up, and the rig thundered on, a wash of displaced air tugging their clothes. Lena swept her bangs from her face and watched the trailer's stenciled letters hurtle past like film in a projector. Sidewinder. In another moment, gone. Just a ring in her ears and the gritty taste of dust.
Idiot, the cop muttered,
I'm really here, she thought. I'm really here, doing this. The dust in her teeth made it real. After months of waiting, 24-year-old Lena was finally here in Montana, miles from home, moving forward, making progress. Another voice, just a faint whisper in her mind. Don't get comfortable. Don't let your guard down. Not even for a second. She caught herself twirling a lock of her hair with her index finger and tugging, a tic she had had since elementary school, and stopped herself. It made her look nervous. Reykjavik didn't notice. He was squinting into the distance.
Hairpin Bridge isn't far from here, but there's zero shade once you're up there. The sun becomes a spotlight, saps your energy. Before we go, do you need anything from the diner? Water, maybe?
I'll buy something.
All right.
He pointed.
I'll start my vehicle. Follow me.
She hurried back inside the air-conditioned Magma Springs diner. She had already waited there for hours today, sipping black coffee as groups of firefighters talked shop over plates of greasy eggs. She pretended to waver at the mini-fridge, stocked with energy drinks and bottled water, and once she was certain Corporal Reykjavik was occupied inside his cruiser and not watching her through the front windows, she returned to her booth. There, she had a laptop on the table. She triple-checked the power cable, the Sony unit, and the connection to the restaurant's router. All good. Thanks again, she said to the lady at the long counter. I'll be back soon.
Is that a college project you're downloading?
Something like that. She followed the cop car east on Highway 200. 15 minutes of fresh asphalt under a horizon banded with smoke. Then Reykjavik veered sharply right, crossing two lanes, as if the turnoff had surprised him. Lena had to stomp on her brakes, grinding rubber. He waved out his window. Sorry. This new road hadn't been maintained for decades. Weeds sprouted through fissures in sun-bleached concrete. The lines were faded. Over a locked metal gate, an equally faded signboard read, Public Use Prohibited. Corporal Reykjavik had the code memorized. After relocking it behind them, he drove on at 75, 15 over the speed limit. She wondered if he was testing her, trying to goad her into a ticket. That would be a dick move. She matched his speed. She would test him, too. She drove in silence. No music or podcasts since she'd left Seattle this morning, because she didn't have the correct dongle to connect to the speakers. She was afraid to touch the CD player or radio presets because the car wasn't hers. It was Cambry's. Had been Cambry's. Driving your dead twin's car is a jarring experience. Their father had urged Lena through teary eyes to accept the vehicle, insisted that this lived-in 2007 Toyota Corolla was one of her sister's few remaining possessions, and it would be wrong to sell it. Maybe so, but today's journey to the dry foothills of Howard County, Montana, was the longest Lena had ever driven it. She hadn't altered anything. Every detail was a freeze frame. The empty 32-ounce fountain drink in the cup holder was Cambry's, sporting a superhero who had already come and gone at the box office. The red cooler full of rotten food. The backup battery, the air compressor, the dirty tool bag. The minimalist living quarters in the back seat, a duffel bag of folded clothes that still had her scent. Separate Ziploc bags containing deodorant, toothpaste, and mouthwash. In the trunk, a two-person tent, an electric grill, and a perfectly rolled sleeping bag. Lena could never roll a sleeping bag that tight. Ever. I'm not just driving her car, she'd realized with a hollow pang, somewhere between Spokane and Coeur d'Alene. I'm driving her house. City girl that she was, Lena couldn't help but marvel at her twin's Spartan lifestyle. The duct tape on the steering wheel, the exposed wires betraying the handmade repairs to the cigarette lighter adapter, the scattered dryer sheets to fight odors, Lena guessed. To change or discard anything here, in this intimate space where her sister had lived capably for over 9 months, felt like a profound insult. So it all remained. Even the moldy food in the cooler, even the fountain drink at her side, sweet-smelling in the sunlight. Cambry's lips had touched it 3 months ago. Maybe her DNA was still on it. You look exactly like her. She was surprised Corporal Reshevik hadn't recognized Cambry's car. He'd found it the same night he found her body. Wouldn't he remember it? His patrol car was still forging ahead, approaching 80 now, so Lena pushed the gas and matched his speed as the road climbed into the foothills. Tires jostled over rough concrete. The land dropped away in places to an alarming vastness on her right, and for a moment, Lena considered how close you are to death on most roads. The buffers are mostly imaginary. You're only a swerve away from an oncoming lane or a ravine. She tried not to think about it. The lodgepole pines grew taller up here, 60, 70 feet. Frayed branches cooked brittle in the sun, standing over floors of brown needles and crunchy juniper. A million acres of tinder, waiting for a spark. And beyond the changing terrain, rising in the distance, she felt a knot tighten in her throat. There it was. The structure was already taking shape over the sloping hills, jagged and unwelcome and thoroughly man-made. An ancient fossil emerging from the land. Oh, Jesus, there it is. She felt her chest tense up as the rust-brown form came into clarity, rivets and girders drawn toothpick-sharp in the sunlight, becoming real before her eyes as the cracked road pulled her closer. She knew she was committed now, that her and Corporal Reshevik's fates were entwined here. She couldn't possibly turn back. As it drew closer, momentarily obscured by another hump of dry pines, she tried to calm her nerves. No battle plan survives first contact with the enemy, right? Still, it looks so much bigger than in the photos.
Before I go, posted 9/20/19 by L. Nguyen. It starts with a bridge. A precarious steel monster with a fierce turn on its south ramp, spanning 600 feet across an obscure valley on the fringes of a bankrupt silver mining town, all rendered perfectly obsolete by the interstate. 70 miles from Missoula. As far as bridges go, it's a total fuck up, and it knows it. It's also where my sister died. Allegedly. Sorry to be heavy, dear readers. I know this blog post isn't my usual writing for lights and sounds, and that may upset some of you. And I appreciate the kind words and FB Insta well wishes over the past few months I've been AWOL. Obvious reasons. Yes, I'm back in the blogging saddle, but not quite how you may expect. And I have a doozy of a post here, so buckle up. But before you read further, this is not my normal blog. This is not a book, movie, or video game review. This is not a political rant. God knows this has been a great year for that. Nor is this poetry, humor, photography, or the long-awaited part 11 of Just Retail Things. This, whatever this is something I need to post here, on Lights and Sounds. To my modest but engaged readership, that's you, for reasons that will soon become clear. By the time you finish reading this, depending on your time zone, I might just be national news. So, sorry in advance if this ruins your whole day. Good? Good. Here we go. I'm spending my Saturday at Hairpin Bridge. Tomorrow morning, at the ass crack of dawn, I'm driving Cambry's car 7 hours east to the town of Magma Springs, Montana, and meeting up with a local highway patrolman named Raymond R. Reshevik. Yes, that's really his name. Apparently, R's were on sale the day his parents named him. Via email, he's kindly agreed to show me, the grieving sister, the exact spot where he discovered Cambry's body 3 months ago. As for Hairpin Bridge, well, dear readers, did that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.